I'm going to finish there. Fantastic. Hello, everybody. I can see everyone's coming into the chat. It's great to be here. This is the last live stream I'm doing of this year, so thank you for coming along. I hope we can make this a productive and good one. I hope you're all fantastic and ready for the Christmas break, whatever you're planning to do, whether you celebrate it or not, that you're able to get some peace and ease at this time of year. Let's have a look who's in the chat. Will, how you doing, dude? Paco Jazztorius, could listen to Sam Jam all day. Thank you so much. That's so kind of you. I couldn't listen to me all day, but I appreciate your kind comments. Keith Moff, good to see you. Blue Sumlin, hello. We've got Trost Jern, good to, happy holidays. Thank you. Happy holidays back to all of you wishing me happy holidays. Thank you. Timothy from Florida Keys, Merry Christmas. Fantastic. Okay, so Kate, hi, sound everyone tonight. Just wished you all good. Very kind of you, Kate. Block 18. There's so many. Great. If I've missed your name, please, I'm here all night for the next half an hour, 40 minutes anyway. We will chat and talk all good things about guitar playing. So the title of this was Powerful 5-Minute Practice Routines. Now, before I get stuck in, I think, if you're spending time with loved ones this Christmas and privileged enough to do so, maybe spending time with them is probably the best thing to do. But if you have a few minutes spare, you've got a guitar in the house, maybe after Christmas dinner, digesting the food, conversations got a bit awkward, head upstairs, grab your guitar. Some things that might be useful. And this is kind of right up my street, really, because I don't really have a practice routine per se, probably clearly in the way I play, but in terms of taking the guitar and finding these pockets of time to work on something which is going to be productive, but rather than necessarily just being productive, something that's enjoyable. And of course, 5 minutes doesn't have to be stuck to. It's just a kind of, a short amount of time. So first of all, as much as I love playing the guitar, you may be stuck without a guitar, and there's lots of practice you can do without a guitar. Now, I am not a scientist, clearly, but I've heard lots of neuroscientists like Bulotto, Sam Harris, Huberman, talking about the fact that visualization and imagining what you're doing is actually kind of helping the neural network. So, the sensation of playing, imagining that, imagining the sound, even, bringing into mind what a pattern looks like in your head is actually a really good thing to practice. It's part of violinists do it. Extreme athletes do it, skiers and Formula One race drivers, they visualize their tracks before going on. So one thing you can do if the conversation is getting boring, you can visualize or hear something in your head. And I think rather than just doing random stuff, you could give yourself a challenge depending on what you're working on. So here's some suggestions. The one that I find myself naturally doing, especially if I've been playing a round of new ideas on the guitar, is actually sort of seeing the chord, like it might be a chord voicing or it might be a scale position, and I'm seeing it's like the notes are lighting up. I'm imagining actually playing it, and I'm trying out different combinations, I'm trying out different stretches and things like that, closing my eyes just because I'm kind of trying to visualize that in my mind's eye. But that enables you to kind of practice those patterns. Now the other side is the audition side. And you can either sing it out loud. I guess if we're talking about the holidays coming up, you don't want to necessarily be sat there, singing intervals out loud randomly during Trivial Pursuits. But you may want to imagine what that sounds like as you're visualizing that. It might be a solo you're learning. Can you bring it to your mind what that first phrase of that solo sounds and looks like on the fretboard, and kind of imagine how it would feel to play. Sounds very crazy, but it's a real way of playing. So that's one aspect. And another thing you can do is active listening. And there's lots of great songs and questionable songs on the radio at this time of year. And it's probably good to listen carefully. You can do things like listen through to a song and see if you can get the structure, if you can count the bars in time, if you can work out what kind of key it's at. Well, not even necessarily perfect pitch, but if you can visualize what the chord progression might be, is it a 1-6-4-5, for example? You can listen through to, if you hear the same song over and over again, each time you hear it, rather than going, what's that, That song annoys me. It's Mariah Carey again. Okay, well, what's the hi-hat doing? What's the drummer doing? You know, how does what they're doing relate to what's going on in the other instrumentation? I know this is licklibrary.com and we're talking about guitars, but really the guitar is just a typewriter for music. So the more aware you are of the music you're listening to around you, the more you're able to pick out things and take inspiration from even the most seemingly kind of, you know, places you'd look for it last. You know, we can't help but be influenced and impressions made upon us from the world around us. That's what we are. We are a process in interaction with that. And we pick up the good stuff and we also pick up the bad stuff. And, you know, consciousness has no bias. It's just, it will take it all in. The aperture is there and you'll pick it up. But if you actively do that, it will be well spent 5 minutes. Most songs are an average of 5 minutes. So there we go. So there are some suggestions there. There's some courses, 5 minute fixes for your playing. That might be a good one if you've got Lick Library on your phone or on your browser, just to bring up one of those lessons and have a follow. That's something that's worth doing too. I would suggest, though, you want to keep it kind of creative and also just something that pushes you in a new direction as well. So let's talk about actually playing the guitar right now. So I've got my, I chose to use this guitar tonight. I love this guitar. This is my Eternal Guitars S-Type. And whilst I double check my tuning, you might have 5 minutes, okay? So there's several approaches. I would argue there is technical and there is creative. And you can mix them together if you want to, if you've got a bit more time. But technical practice, you know, if you've got 5 minutes, you know, put in a drum loop on. Take one sequence, okay? You might have a pentatonics in fours. You might have a lick, and I always, when I say lick as a teacher, I go, it might be that, okay? Maybe the goal now is, you know, that's pentatonic, so maybe, you know, maybe learn how to do that in another position of the pentatonic scale. Or can you kind of transpose the lick? Can you take elements of it and move it to somewhere else? Now, that might seem like super simple, but sometimes the most biggest changes to our playing and also quite enjoyable things that we can be practicing are simple. Not necessarily, don't have to be kind of, you know, having to practice giant steps on a ukulele, even though you're a guitarist, and on the top of a mountain through, you know, just direct into a interface or something. It doesn't have to be kind of sadistic. It can be simple and joyful and practical. Okay, so cool. Blues has got a, Blues Summon says, problem is my intention is 5 minutes, but ends up being an hour or more. Well, that's okay. That's cool too. That's good. That's good. So, yeah, practicing your sequences, doing some picking stuff. You know, you might just, you know, kind of refresh your scales. Just go through all the positions. My suggestion would be, I'm actually going to, have I got a drum loop on here? I'm just going to get a drum loop going on. Where is my drum gone? I don't know where my drums are. So I've actually got a project open right now. Okay, here's my little drum loop. So practicing in time with something. So maybe that's what I've decided to practice. And I'm doing that as 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a 1. Okay, how about triplet eighth notes? So that's cool. Maybe could I do go between eighths and sixteenths? So like this, I go one and one and cool. So you could test out, like, you know, manipulating that sequence of different rhythms. That's a really good thing to practice. And actually, going back to the I forgot, there's one element I forgot to mention about practicing without a guitar. is counting. You know, it might be worth picking up some paradiddles or some rhythms and seeing if you can actually count them out in your head, or if you can, if you're listening to a piece of music, you know, work out what the subdivisions are that are being played. You know, is the solo got longer notes or shorter notes? Another one for without a guitar, and this will relate to the guitar as well in a moment, it might be to listen to your favourite solo, and rather than learn the solo, look at the elemental parts of the solo. Like, does it start on the low E string and go up? Does it sound like it to you? Can you recognise the difference between a slide and a bend? Can you, are you noticing either a certain phrases repeating? Either is there any rhythmic motifs going through the melodies? Is there a melodic motif going through the rhythms? How does it start? How does it finish? Does it quote something from the song? All of these kind of more artistic elements that you can actually recycle and use in your musicianship are actually kind of the things that help the most and become the, you know, your technique then will come to serve that stuff. So cool. So 1980 says, what are the dynamics you are applying, want to learn? I'm not sure I understand the question, but you're welcome to give that. Let me know if there's rephrase it in a different way, maybe, so I may be able to understand. So another one might be to stick on a drum loop and practice improvising in different ways using limitations. That's a really healthy creative way. You might, for example, this is a, you know, well tried and tested one. I'm just going to put on a bit of bass guitar. So I'm in A minor. And I might choose just to improvise on one string. So what I might do to start my practice session is work out my A minor scale, then go backwards, sort of set the table for dinner, so to speak, if you've not already been doing that already for Christmas dinner. And then I'm gonna sort of try and improvise within 4-bar phrases and try and finish an idea. So there, I kind of decided to, rather than just endlessly play, I was giving myself a limitation and giving myself a time limit to kind of finish, start and finish an idea, rather than just kind of noodle off into, you know, shred territory, sort of thing like that. I'll see if I can do that. Another thing you could do similar is actually, I call it phrasing dominoes. I don't know how to play dominoes, but, you know, if you have like a 2 and a 3, and then you connect a 3 on another piece to a 4, and then a 4 onto a, I don't know. But what I mean by that is you play one phrase and try and keep the other phrase to do with the last phrase. And then the next phrase after that will be to do with the previous phrase. So it'll be like 1, 2, 2 relates to 1, and then 3 will relate to 2, etc. So that would sound like this. And this helps you keep on track of your phrasing. So maybe my number one piece is, so ascending. So ascending and descending. Okay, so that enabled me to elongate a phrase. And this is beyond technique, beyond, you don't have to have any special fretboard knowledge apart from maybe a few scale positions, but limiting yourself and making sure that your phrases actually have something to do with each other. Imagine that I suddenly now started talking about carrier bags now going from 15p to 20p in most supermarkets. And I scratched my car the other day because I was quite tired and I got a new car. Well, not a new car, but the doesn't have parking sensors on it. And I accidentally went into a bollard. But it's okay because the sunset this evening was really cool. I don't know what was going on yesterday. There was actually a kind of rainbow in the sky. So that whole sentence there, it's kind of like how we play when we play just random licks or we forget what we're doing. But this whole practice idea of guitar dominoes, so there's different elements there. I kind of stuck with a pattern, so, and then I thought, okay, I'm going to say that my domino piece that I was trying to connect there was, rather than going somewhere else, was to stick with that positioning. And then, but when I did that second phrase, there's a rhythm there I quite liked. So So I tried to follow that same contour, but within a different area. Super simple things to practice, but this is like, this is the real stuff. This is creating, and this is improvising. This is not just reciting, you know, pre-learned material necessarily. This is learning to express on the guitar. And if you have 5 minutes to practice, very healthy thing to work on. Cool. I'm just going to check in on the comments here. So I believe in thinking patterns. And sometimes I can't stop playing in my head, and I have been guilty of that too. I find it helps memory going over what you've learned virtually in your head. Absolutely. So, you know, and it's a valid way of practicing, because if, you know, Steve Vai has often talked about visualize everything, and people, you know, people can think it's a bit kind of woo-woo and stuff, but it's real. I mean, we live our lives in our imaginations anyway, so you might as well do some practice whilst you're there. You know, always thinking about things when actuality is nothing to do with our thoughts. So practicing can be done in that way. I think that's quite a useful thing to do. Intervals, says 1980. What are the intervals you're applying, want to learn? I see, cool. So intervals, I mean, well, that's, I mean, let's just open this up as a thing. Maybe your limitation is to play fifth-based intervals within the improvisation. So I make melodies of just fifths within the scale. Okay, can I do a fourth space thing? So fourth intervals within the key. How about thirds? Thirds always sound very nice and melodic. Bit was, it was like a hiccup. So you know, you could practice that in more of a with or without the guitar thing. You could practice your intervals by themselves. You could take a root note and you could say A on the D string, and then I want you to find a minor third from there. So you find a minor third from the A on the D string. Okay, can I find a minor third from A on the G? Okay. Or can I find a minor third off the E string? Can I find a minor third an octave higher than the E string? So little things like that. You could just do that with just the root, third and fifth. That's a good practice. Beyond scale patterns, that's the kind of Tom Quayle jazz method of visualizing the fretboard. Just seeing one interval and knowing the kind of makeup of whatever chord you're playing over. Very, very useful way of learning to play. After a certain point, working on repertoire is way more beneficial. All the exercises, warm-ups and routines and songs and riffs and solos are... Yeah, absolutely. I would say that there's something to be said for that, absolutely. Depends on what your goals are as a musician. If you're looking at doing covers and just learning your favourite songs, and I play professionally other people's songs, and that's good to have. And I would agree, most of my practice is just kind of, if I'm doing anything technical, it's always something musical from a song. But then also it's important to practice kind of manipulating the information on the fly and actually saying something of your own on the instrument. Not that we can actually truly say anything that's our own, because it's impossible. You can't just invent random new words, but you can say them in different ways, and you can be an aperture for your own kind of point of view on the guitar, which I think is really cool. Cool. So, yeah, so that's some ways of practicing. Another one you might want to do is, I mean, this backing track, I released some new songs recently on my Bandcamp, but this one hasn't been released. This is like a synth thing. This chord progression is simply this. So D minor, G7, F major 7. Maybe you want to practice your cage system. Don't take my song, but maybe a song you already know and you know the chords. Okay, how many ways can you play that chord progression? that's one way. Do I know some extensions? Let's do D minor 9 this time. Let's do G11 to an F major 7 in first inversion. Okay, let's do D minor as a third inversion. This is G7. G7 sus 2 and then F major 9. So, you know, you might take, you know, just see how many different ways you can play a chord progression. It's quite nice. So it leads to some very melodic results. Let's take that over the backing track for option. So maybe just get some reverb on. Well, I've got some reverb, that's okay. You know, can you improvise of just chords? Hey, if you can improvise of chords, you can kind of do all the chord tone soloing stuff anyway, and you're working on something I would argue more important than just practicing your scales, and that is knowing your chords cage system. So I hope this is making sense. Cool. Jason, hello. Perfect subject. I get home from work absolutely exhausted. I pick up the guitar and noodle whilst watching some YouTube. Not exactly practice, is it? Well, if you enjoy it, that's cool. If I would say that giving yourself just a small little bit of a limitation is going to help push you in some small way. It might be I'm going to noodle, but I'm going to only noodle on one string. You might be working on some technique and you might try and push yourself with a pattern, try and get it a bit quicker. Maybe that's your little goal, just to kind of push it. And 5 minutes is perfect for speed practice as well. It might be that, you know, there's a scale position that you're a bit dusty on, so you might practice some licks in that position over a backing track. You know, and you're still doing your own thing, you're still letting off steam, but you're also giving yourself some new territory. And arguably, you know, there's a great neuroscientist called Bew Lotto. I'd recommend anybody that's interested in all the mindset stuff is check him out. It talks about the power of awe and how, you know, the brain's always looking to make sense of everything constantly. You know, everything we see isn't necessarily what we see. It's kind of an interpretation. And, you know, we look at a camera like I am now and you go, camera. But when you introduce, if this looked like something I've never seen before, there'd be like a kind of openness and new pathways being made. And it's the same with practice. If you've got 5 minutes, try something, just a small one thing to push, you know, that curiosity somewhere else. And it doesn't have to be Einstein level groundbreaking stuff. It can just be playing a lick in a different position. It can be, I don't know, playing without a pick for 5 minutes, or playing of a different tone, even playing over a different tempo, playing a backing track in a different key than you would normally go into. All these little things can be enough to make a considerable difference, and most importantly, enjoyable. I mean, we play games because they're difficult, they challenge us, they make us think. And it's the same with guitar. It's not in kind of like a you should be disciplined way, but just as a curious thing, right? There we are. We spend lots of time on reverb.com looking at overdrive pedals, so why not spend some time on the guitar learning about some new possibilities for ourselves based upon what we want to do. Anyway, sorry, I'm talking so much. I don't know what that was. Cool. Blue Summoning, I find 5 minute routines help my songwriting. I tend to get writer's block. Yeah, I had the same thing at the weekend. I was having a bit of a downtime with guitar because I've been doing lots of kind of, I love teaching, but I hadn't done much writing of music. And I just spent the weekend just writing, and I gave myself 3 hours and I wrote a whole new song called Chop Wood, Carry Water. And it's just really fun because I didn't have time to overthink it. I gave myself the goal of finishing it. And I made it simple for myself. I didn't judge what I was doing too much, but I kind of was curious. And actually, when you get out of the way, new stuff comes in. It's great. Really good. Chris Mullen, did you refer to a book, The Power of Awe? No. I was talking about a neuroscientist called B-E-A-U, Lotto. Quite interesting. I'll write it in the comments. I think Stu's already got it. Yeah, interesting. I don't, you know, it's all food for thought, really. 1980, what are the tone you're using? I'm just using a quad cortex, and it's just a plexi. It's quite a revealing tone. And then I've got a bit of a tape delay on top. And most of the tone comes from, you know, pickups, and I like to sort of angle the pick. You know, sometimes on a neck pickup I might angle quite. Versus. And then legato. Like, for me, like, that sounds cool, but maybe legato might work nicer for certain things. So you know, the tone coming from the techniques as well as what's going on with the gear. Anyway, I think most modelers can do a Marshall plexi. You know, don't overthink tone either. That's another one. Oof, God, you can go down some rabbit holes and spend a lot of money when you could just practice for 5 minutes. Although gear is really fun and it does inspire you to do new things. Cool. Odge UK says, confused by learning intervals relative to root notes. Should I learn them from my root notes on the G, B and E strings too? Absolutely. You'll find though, let me just, Tom Quayle has some fantastic lessons on this stuff. I think there is actually a course on Licklibrary Rock to Fusion that talks about this, but I'll do my own interpretation of it. You know, for example, a minor third on the low E string has this shape. It's got its own shape. Okay. Ooh. Sorry, my camera's just turned off. So it's got its own shape, but that shape will remain the same pretty much on off all strings, apart from the G and B. But so if I know A on the B string, it's the same. And then you got it here. You also got, I mean, the B string, because of the tuning, it would just be one higher. So once you've learnt it in one position, you kind of have it everywhere. There might be some caveats to that. For example, you got the two adjacent strings versus... If there's 12 notes, then there's 12 intervals. And there's probably at least one or two ways of articulating them off any given place on the guitar neck. So that's 12 times... There's maybe 24 possibilities. I'm not sure. And then there's below the root note as well. But yeah. Scott, have you tried Tom Quayle's app? Yeah, I've got it. It's a great app. Fantastic. I barely use it, but that's because I'm lazy. But I think that's a fantastic tool. Absolutely. Really good tool if you're looking at getting intervals down. For me, I see intervals and I also see chord shapes, and I use whatever. It's all useful, isn't it? All tools to be used. Jason Paris, he's got a few TED Talks. Yeah, check them out. They're quite interesting. You know, take what's interesting, leave the rest if you're into that sort of thing. Okay. Cool. I also recommend a book by Krishnamurti called Freedom from the Known. That's a really good book about kind of our biases and our conditioning. Quite an interesting one if you're looking at that sort of thing. It has nothing to do with guitar playing, but, you know, we're here to talk about stuff. Cool. Smash the like button. Yeah, thank you, Blues. I appreciate that. Okay, well, I'm going to start wrapping up soon. We're a bit shorter tonight as it is a Friday. But it's been an absolute pleasure. I really enjoy doing these things, and there'll be plenty more in the new year. And do keep in touch as well. Keep in touch with the Licklibrary page. If you have any more questions, I hope I've kind of addressed things in a way that have been useful. But 5-minute practice routines, if I'm going to summarize that, you know, do something, use a limitation that pushes you into a kind of slightly unknown, not completely unknown. Obviously, you don't want to like look down at the guitar and it's just, you know, the gaping void of existence staring back at you. You don't really want that. What you want is maybe, oh, I know this position of the pentatonic, but there's a dusty bit here, I'm going to go there. Or, you know, oh, I know this chord progression really well, maybe I'll try and play it with some other inversions and see if there's other options. Or, you know, or one more thing. Always good. Try and figure something out by ear in 5 minutes. That's going to be super helpful. It's cool because you get the satisfaction of learning something new. You get the satisfaction of using your ear And it can be as simple as you want. And I'm going to give you permission to, you know, even if it's like a really technical riff and you manage to figure it out with one finger on one string, it doesn't matter. Even if it's just following the root notes of a, you know, chord progression, that doesn't matter. Because everything, every time you do something by ear, it's going to make you a better musician. It's going to make you understand how to find things on the neck, and you're developing that network of connection between the brain and the instruments. And there we are. Cool. Friday night special. Cheers, everyone. Thank you so much for tuning in. It's been an absolute pleasure. Randy Rhodes riff stuff. All I can say is I'm sure there are some great Randy Rhodes lessons on licklibrary.com. I've not really, I mean, I love Randy Rhodes, amazing, but I don't know any of his stuff really on guitar. I never sat down and learned it. I just appreciate what he does. Cool. Timothy, you learn every note of well done. Fantastic. I'm jealous because I'd love to learn the rest of that solo too. That's great. Fantastic. Nice work, Timothy. Cool. Keith, thank you. Jason. Scott, Chris, Blue Sumlin, thank you all of you for tuning in. I hope you have a fantastic holiday, full of peace, full of ease, full of joy, all that good stuff. Yeah, Chris, hit that thumbs up button. That is useful. I hate saying that, but thank you for saying that for me. It does help Lick Library. It helps me. And it helps us all, because if more people get these, then there's more of them regularly, and we can all talk about guitar, which is pretty cool. All right. Take care. See you soon. And come to licklibrary.com. Have a fantastic Christmas, and all the best for 2024.